When I started playing the guitar, one of the first influences I can ever remember was the late, great Elvis Presley. And it was many years later, when we're actually, ELP was on its first tour of the United States, and we were actually here in San Francisco, and we had a day off. And my manager at the time, a gentleman called D. Anthony, said to me, you know what, Greg, rather than just sit around the hotel on your day off, would you like to go and see Elvis perform? And I said, wow, you know, because the thing was, Elvis never came to the UK, he never came to England. So, although we obviously knew about the records and the legend, we'd never seen him perform live. I'd never seen him perform live. So, this was really exciting. And he said, well, he's on in Lake Tahoe. You know, we can quickly hop on a plane and we'll go over and see him. So, that's what we did. And I always remember walking into the casino to watch him, and we went into this cabaret room, and you know, the sort of thing, they had these semi-circular red leather, I think they call them banquette seats, and the tables with the two lamps on. And I remember thinking at the time that, I mean, this room was maybe 1,500, 1,800 seats, and at the time, ELP were actually playing bigger places. And I thought to myself, wow, you know, this can't be right. I mean, I think I was afraid of seeing a fake Elvis. And, my manager said, no, Greg, just take a seat and watch, you're going to learn something. And so we sat down, and after a while, the house lights went down. And they started to play this music from 2001. It's called Das Beg Zarathustra. It's horrible to say, but you know the piece. It goes, bum, 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 ba, bum, 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 bum. And very dramatic. And all of a sudden, behind the curtains, I heard an electric guitar and a snare drum. Bam, bam, ba, ba. Bam, bam, ba. The curtains open, and there is Elvis. He's standing with his back to the audience, and they're shining a spotlight up at him and projecting his shadow, maybe 30 or 40 feet tall, on this huge screen in the back. It was unbelievably impressive. And in a flash, he just spun round, going to a party in the county jail, and three women just fainted. They just fainted. And, you know, he did 30 seconds of jailhouse rock. And then he went straight into, since my baby left me, I found a new place to dwell. Heartbreak Hotel, he did 30 seconds of that. And then he went into, you ain't nothing but a hound dog. And he did 30 seconds of that. He'd been on for 2 minutes. And at the end of it, of course, there was this rapturous applause. And he went up to the microphone. I'll never forget it. He went up to the microphone and he said, oh, thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I'm really not worth it. And I thought then, you know, what have you got to do to be worth it? You know? And anyway, you know, after 2 minutes of Elvis, place looked like a refugee camp. There was bottles tipped over, there was ladies with makeup running down their face. It looked like a bomb had hit the place. And in a way it had. And then Elvis, just as if to twist the knife a little bit, he did Love Me Tender, Love Me True. Of course everybody knows it. So the show went by like a flash, as you can imagine. If anyone's seen Elvis live, then you know what I'm talking about. It's just an amazing show to watch. And, it ended up, he was playing one of these up-tempo numbers, I think it was Poke Salad Annie, one of these things. And in the end, he just ran off the stage. And the band kept playing. And then eventually, the band stopped. They didn't come to a sort of organized stop. they just sort of fell apart. It just crumbled into nothing. And then they switched the house lights on. These bright fluorescent daylight lamps. They just lit the place up like daylight. And a voice came over the PA and it said, you know what I'm going to say, don't you?
Yes.
Ladies and gentlemen, Elvis has left the building. And you felt dreadful. You felt awful, gutted. I mean, 30 seconds before, you were looking at the most handsome man in the world, you know. Jet black, blue black hair, suntan to die for, pearl white teeth, and a voice from the heavens, you know. And all of a sudden, you were looking at Beirut on a bad day. And anyway, we all shuffled out and went outside into the open air. And my manager said, well, there you are, Greg. Now you've seen Elvis. You know what it's all about. And, of course, I was very grateful to have seen this iconic, legendary singer that had inspired me so much. But also, I also felt quite depressed because, I mean, I just knew I'd never be that good. And it bothered me for a long time. But in the end, of course, I mean, you have to accept that you are who you are, and I am who I am, and I eventually got over it, you know. Didn't work out too bad, but, you know, it was... But, you know, it was a lesson in humility, and it was certainly an inspiration. And, but, you know, you've got to be either very brave or very stupid to do an Elvis song, because you're not going to look good by comparison. I'm certainly not brave. But where I come from, it's a county in England, it's called Dorset. And they have a saying there, it's a farming community. And they have a saying there, it says, Dorset born, Dorset bred, strong in the arm, but weak in the head. And I think there's probably a little bit of truth to it. And anyway, whatever it is, I'm going to try and do it as a tribute to the King. I'd like to do what I think is the greatest rock song ever written. It's called Heartbreak Hotel.
You're making me so lonely. You're making me so lonely. You're making me so lonely.
you so lonely, I could die.